this presentation is trying to give you data points through which you will be in a better position to understand how this markets can evolve. Avinash, next slide, please. Today, entire global economy is worried about what is happening in Russia and Ukraine. On one side, there is physical war where Russian forces are invading Ukraine and Ukrainians are giving a fierce fight. On the other hand is the financial war where Western world led by US is putting sanctions on Russia and other markets. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, your voice is proper.
Okay. Now, because of this invasion, clearly one impact is on the commodity prices. Russia is one of the second largest producer of oil and gas. That resulted into oil prices shooting. They are also large producer of metals like nickel, aluminium, steel. All those things have started moving up. Ukraine is one large producer of oil, wheat and other agri commodities. So commodity prices have crossed all-time high level on the index. Next slide, please. When commodity prices rises, inflation starts inching up. US inflation is now above Indian inflation for last 6 months. All over the world, we are seeing inflation levels rising. Generally, we have seen that whenever crude prices shoots through the roof, it has led to recession in America. Will this time be different or will it follow the global pattern? Undoubtedly, rising energy prices and Ukraine invasion will result into slowdown in growth. In Russia, the growth has been revised downwards by more than 1.2%. Even in Europe, UK, US, there has been reduction in growth projection. Equity markets, not only in developed markets, but also in emerging markets have corrected thanks to the invasion. This has happened through valuation correction, as P/E ratio of NASDAQ has declined from about 35 to about 25. And today it will be even lower than that. It's slowly and steadily coming to its historical averages of about 20, 21 times forward earning. In this correction, the 52-week lows have reached highest in last three decades in NASDAQ 100 index. This is despite the fact that S&P 500 earning per share before this invasion was at all-time high level. Central bankers are still in easing mode. They are still printing money to support growth. Now the question is, will central bank take away liquidity, raise interest rates as was expected before the Ukraine invasion, or they will stop taking away liquidity and raising interest rates because higher commodity prices are impacting growth? In the case of US, they are in perfect storm. If you look at their government debt to GDP ratio, it's already crossing all-time high level. If you look at their valuation, despite earnings run up, it is at higher level. And inflation is again at near all-time high level. US is in a situation where debt is high, inflation is high, and growth is likely to be subdued. Generally, we have seen then Fed raises interest rates. Normally, it is preceded by strong business cycle. Because businesses are doing well, Fed raises interest rates. And in that scenario, equity markets by and large have done well. Even Indian equity market in the same period have delivered mostly positive return, except one period between December 93 to April 1995. So this time when Fed is likely to raise interest rates, will it be like the past where equity markets in US as well as in India deliver positive return? Or will it be different this time? As I mentioned in the beginning of my speech, invasions provide an opportunity to buy, as we have seen during Vietnam War, Gulf War, or Afghanistan War, or Iraq War. But the real question is that when you are in the war, how do you predict the outcome? How do you predict what will happen to commodities? What will happen to the valuations? The one big fear which market today is worried about is, will this conflict between Russia and Ukraine end up becoming multi-country conflict? Today, there are countries, and there are about 20 of them in US and Europe, which are supplying weapons to Ukraine. Will Russia take all of them as enemy? Will Russia start attacking them? If that happens, can this become World War III? This is something which market is worried about. Now, in that backdrop where we have more questions and less answers, let's look at the Indian economy headline. The GST collection remains robust. It is above 1 lakh crore. PMI, after little drop, has recovered to 55. Maruti Suzuki production came down to 95% level. EV bills daily run rate was highest in February 22. Monsoon is likely to be normal, and our food grain production will be at all-time high of 316 million tons. The business recovery index, it was at about 101.8 during Omicron wave, but now it has recovered back to 123, which is almost all-time high level. Next slide, please. The GDP growth came in at 5.4% for December quarter. It was lower than expected at 5.9%, showing some impact of slowdown. However, our growth rate is one of the highest in the emerging market and developed market. Our agriculture growth continues to be strong, and good monsoon will ensure that next year also remains positive. One silver lining of this Russia-Ukraine invasion is that Ukraine will stop selling agriculture goods, including wheat, to the outside world, and we could step in place of Ukraine to provide agriculture food grains. Next slide, please. Our exports have started increasing in chemicals, textiles, agriculture, machinery, base metal, automobiles, as well as electronics. This year, we should be touching about $400 billion of exports. Before February 21, there was only 1 month when we had touched $30 billion exports on a monthly basis. Post February 21, every month we have been doing $30 billion exports. So in the exports market, India is doing well. The capital expenditure cycle continues to remain positive. With steel, cement, sugar, renewable energy sector coming to spend money. Our non-financial debt to GDP ratio also remains fairly low compared to the rest of the world. Our real challenge in this conflict is the oil prices. Oil prices is our Kundli's Rahu as well as Ketu. Whenever oil prices go up, our inflation goes up, our current account deficit widens, and our GDP growth comes down. This is Nomura's estimate. For every 10% rise in crude, our GDP growth comes down by 20 basis points, inflation goes up by 40 basis points, and current account deficit widens by 30 basis points. Last time when we saw $100 of crude, at that point of time, our current account deficit as a percentage of GDP was 1.3%. Today, it is 1.6%. Our foreign exchange reserve was $316 billion. Today, it is $630 billion. Our foreign exchange reserves in terms of import cover were 7 times, now it is 10 times. CPI inflation was almost in similar range at 6%, and GDP growth is much higher now, but that is because we are coming out of pandemic. If you look at Nifty performance in rising crude, clearly, there are different time periods where crude is rising from a lower base, the impact is far less. But where crude is rising from a higher base, impact is far more. Similarly, when markets are in cheap mode and crude rises, it doesn't impact market much. But when markets are in expensive mode and crude rises, the corrections are deeper. Clearly, at this point of time, our market was in fair value zone, and hence a rising crude is having impact on the market. If you look at equity market, this data is as of 28th of Feb. Clearly, now large caps have started doing better then small and mid caps in correction. They are down about 3% in 1 month, whereas mid caps and small caps are down about 7 and 11%. On a year to date basis, the numbers almost are similar. Large cap down about 3%, mid cap down about 7%, and small cap down about 13%. The only sector which has given positive return this year, this calendar year, are energy, metals, banks, and private sector banks. Because we had done so well compared to others, our weight in MSCI moved from 8% to 12%. Now with correction, probably this should have come down a little bit. MSCI is also going to remove Russia from MSCI index. It's just about 1.5% of MSCI index, and their removal is not going to make a material change to India's weightage, but analysts expect that we may get $600 million of inflows if Russia is made to zero in MSCI emerging market index. Next slide, please. From a valuation point of view, we are at significant premium to other emerging markets, as we did well and those countries didn't, which is the reason why FPIs are selling aggressively. So far, they have sold about $10 billion from October 21. This is the second highest selling by FPIs since 2008. In 2008, they had sold about $16 billion of Indian equity. This run, they have sold $10 billion and it is still counting. This time, FPI selling has been more calibrated. In March and April 20, they sold 68,000 crore worth of equity. In direction from top was about 38%, 12,300 Nifty to 7,500 Nifty. In October to February, they have sold close to 1 lakh crore. In the first few days of March, they have sold close to $2 billion, which is 15,000 crore more. And yet the correction from top was about 12%. This is partly driven by calibrated selling by FPIs. In March, April, they were selling without any price limit. Now they are selling with calibrated manner. The FPI selling March, April 20 has limited impact, because domestic investors have been big buyers of equity in October to February 22 period. Next slide, please. From a valuation point of view, we believe we are now coming to historical average, hence equal allocation. And momentum-wise, there is negative momentum right now, thanks to the news around Ukraine. Next slide, please. Against our historical GDP, market cap to GDP ratio of 76%, now we are at 109%, against global average of 132%. While we are trading at premium to our historical average, compared to global, there is a huge discount. Next slide, please. On a 1 year forward basis, we are now reaching almost our historical average. 1 year forward is about 19.4 times. Historical is about 18.3 times. Below historical averages, we will change our asset allocation call to overweight equity. If you look at December quarterly results in Nifty 50, we are on course to achieve roughly about 736 EPS for FY22 and 877 EPS for FY23 and about 1000 EPS for FY24. We believe this number can get revised down to 825 if oil prices remain high. And this number will come down to about 950 if oil prices continue to remain high. Next slide, please. The same thing visualized in different format. This is the Nifty EPS expected based on December quarterly results. We think 877 has a downside of roughly about 825 rupees. If oil remains at current level for rest of the year. whether oil remains here or not, only God knows. But this is the range one can expect in profitability at current level of oil prices. Our call continues to remain marginal overweight large cap, marginally underweight small and mid cap, and equal weight to equities. As our market comes down to historical averages, we will slowly, slowly change our call to overweight equity when markets are below historical averages. In crisis like this, we must remember that when you evaluate daily price chart, it looks like this. Yearly price chart looks like this. And decadal price chart looks like this. Next slide, please. These are some signs of excessiveness and extremism. This is worth copying and keeping in your pocket. And every time you see this signs emerging, you know market is either topping out or market is bottoming out. Next slide, please. The biggest concern for market is Ukraine, Russia. They are also keeping a watch on what China will do with Taiwan. India-China borders also remain hot. And Houthis versus Middle East also remains a concern, especially with Russian invasion of Ukraine, as oil prices could flare up. Will Fed raise interest rates faster? Fed today is like a firefighter who is watching inflation at a high level, but they are not taking any action. Neither they have raised interest rates, nor they have stopped giving away liquidity. It's like a firefighter who is adding petrol so that fire becomes properly lit. India's inflation is about 6%, and policy rate is about 4%. US inflation is 7.5%, and their policy rate is 0 to 0.25%. Will Fed fight to regain its credibility? Well, their job has got more complicated thanks to higher energy prices and inflation. From an Indian point of view, equity valuation will have impact from rising inflation, RBI raising interest rates, or taking away liquidity. We'll have to see how finely this balance is priced. If we look at corporate earnings, we have seen some amount of margin compression in December 2021 results over December 20 or September 21 results, bearing few sectors like chemicals, where quarter on quarter there was positive margin expansion. In most of the other sector, margins contracted as companies incurred cost to increase volume. What could be silver lining in this dark cloud? One, Iran and US are close to reviving Iranian nuclear deal. If that happens, Iranian oil could start coming into the market and provide much needed respite on the higher oil prices. Today in Business Standard, there is a report that Russia is offering their crude at 25 to 30% discount to India. Now, if we can revive rupee ruble trade, then maybe we will be in a position to buy Russian crude at a cheaper prices than global level. And that will make our business more competitive in exports market. What should we be looking at current level of market? Well, as I mentioned earlier, it's difficult to predict end of the war and outcomes. Markets do recover after the war, but during the war, it's difficult to predict where it will end and how it will end. We believe this is still equal weight market. Valuations are now coming down to historical averages. One can maintain equal weight allocation to equity. If you are underweight to equity, don't be in a hurry to invest into the market at one go. Try to invest on a gradual basis in this correcting market. We believe markets will be volatile. There will be many ups and downs on the basis of unfolding of events and news. So one will have to be careful in adding during this correction. Obviously, you should be looking at funds which are generating alpha over benchmark indices. I am happy to report that across most of the funds in Kotak family, we have been able to add value to our customers. Next slide, please. This is in the hybrid category. Previous one was in the pure equity fund category. If you look at systematic investment plan, not only the returns are in double digit in equity funds and high single digit in hybrid funds, but also they have delivered alpha in most of the cases. Again, SIP in hybrid funds continue to not only deliver double digit return, but also positive alpha in most cases. Balance Advantage Fund is one fund which rises when markets are going up and falls less when markets are going down. In Kotak Balance Advantage Fund, we have about 58% participation when Nifty is going up and about 34% participation when Nifty is falling. This creates a scenario where the upside potential of the fund is far higher than the downside potential of the fund. Compared to Nifty, this fund has upside downside ratio of 1.7 times, which means it goes 1.7 times more on the way up compared to on the way down compared to Nifty. This is something which we have created for the first time. Suppose if there are very conservative, super conservative investors, we will recommend them to do SIP in their equity portfolio, in their equity allocation to funds like Kotak Debt Hybrid Fund, whose equity allocation ranges from 10 to 25%, Kotak Equity Savings Fund, whose equity allocation ranges from 10 to 50%, Kotak Balance Advantage Fund, whose equity allocation ranges from 20 to 80%, and Kotak Equity Hybrid Scheme, whose equity allocation ranges from 65 to 80%. This four funds combined SIP will be appropriate for super conservative investors. When you go to conservative investors, you can look at Equity Savings, Balance Advantage, Equity Hybrid, Blue Chip and Flexi Cap kind of fund so that the clients get right risk reward profile based on their conservative risk profile. For average investors, they can look to invest through SIP in Blue Chip fund, a large cap fund, Equity Opportunities fund, a large and mid cap fund, Flexi Cap and Multi Cap fund, and Emerging Equity, which is a mid-cap fund. For aggressive investors, they can look at emerging equity, which is a mid-cap fund, small-cap fund, multi-cap fund, equity opportunities fund, and focused equity fund. They can even look at a pioneer kind of fund, which is investing into offshore companies also. And for aggressive investors, they can look at emerging equity, small cap focused, or any of the thematic sectoral fund from our portfolio. This is broadly the kind of SIP portfolio to be created for a customer depending upon their risk profile. Should we invest in gold? If you remember, we gave positive view on gold during COVID-19 time. It worked beautifully in December 20 year ended, where gold delivered 18% return. It didn't work in Jan to December, where gold delivered negative 4% return. But fortunately now, with gold almost touching $2,000, again, year to date 22, gold call has started working for investors. We still believe that one can remain overweight gold, but at least with a 3 to 5 year horizon. In that time horizon, we believe gold will outperform fixed income. Why do we remain bullish about gold? Well, if you look at globally, maximum flows have come into gold miners ETF, which kind of shows investors' disposition towards gold. If you look at Russia, they reduced their investments in US Treasury and kept on increasing their allocation to gold. This has come handy for them in this Ukraine crisis. Will China learn something from this and transfer part of their large $3 trillion FX reserves into gold? We believe it is quite likely. And hence, central bank buying will support gold prices. We also believe there will be cryptocurrencies backed by gold on the line of stable coins. This also will create demand for gold. Finally, if you look at gold versus S&P 500 ratio, after years of falling, it has made a bottom and started rising. We believe gold will outperform fixed income over next 3 to 5 years, albeit be ready for a year like 2021, where gold delivered negative return. Coming to the fixed income, well, in the fixed income market, liquidity is like iceberg. What is visible liquidity is a small percentage of what is locked in or invisible liquidity. In the fixed income market, as of today, about 2 lakh crore is the daily liquidity which is there in the banking system, and rest of the liquidity has been captured through variable reverse repo auctions or through central government borrowing stroke tax collection. The size of the government borrowing program at roughly about 11 lakh crore is very, very large. In 2013, the monthly borrowing on net basis was about 35,000 crore. Today, it is about 1,15,000 crore. What was borrowed monthly has now become weekly through this large borrowing program. The inflation numbers have remained stable under RBI's target range, but it is likely to be revised upwards from FY20 projection of 4.5% thanks to the rising oil prices. Compared to rest of the world, our real interest rates are positive. As I explained, US inflation is 7%, interest rate is 0%. In our case, our inflation is about 6% and interest rate is about 4%. We do have negative real rate of interest, but compared to others, it is far lower. If you look at current spread of 10-year government securities minus overnight rate against historical average of 161 basis point, we are at 356 basis point. If you look at vis-a-vis US against historical average of 4.5%, we are at 4.9%. Clearly, it shows that our yield curve is today discounting lots of variability, lots of potential RBI actions. The yield curve remains fairly steep, and we believe yield curve between 2 years to 6 years provide best opportunity from investment point of view. SDL has better carry than government securities. The gap is almost 50 basis point. On the debt side, we believe interest rates will remain rising or elevated. It will come down when RBI will intervene, but it will rise when RBI will not intervene. In such scenario, while market has discounted lots of RBI's action, short to medium end or be in dynamic bond fund. From a debt investment point of view, in the short term, look at money market, savings fund or low duration fund. Over medium term, you can look at corporate bond fund, floating rate short-term bond fund or PSU debt fund. And over long-term with 3 year plus view, one can look at dynamic fund or bond fund. Dynamic bond fund has continued to do well. And over the years, it has generally outperformed benchmark indices. For investors who are invested into debt and who are worried about lower return, mid-single digit return, we will recommend them to have a look at Kotak Debt Hybrid Scheme. It invests between 10 to 25% in equity, or Kotak Equity Savings, which invests between 10 to 50% in equity, or Kotak Equity Hybrid Scheme, which invests between 65 to 80% in equity. All this fund have delivered alpha as well as double digit return to investors, and this correction provides great opportunity to enter. Like our balance advantage fund, which has higher upside to downside ratio, same thing our multi asset allocator fund has similar upside to downside ratio. On the way up, it participates about 65%. And on the way down, it participates about 27%, creating an upside to downside ratio of about 2.39%. For debt investors, one can look to do asset allocation like this. In a cheap market, go to blue chip kind of large cap fund. In a neutral market, go to equity hybrid scheme. And in an expensive market, go to debt hybrid scheme. Or you can invest in multi-asset allocator fund and leave to the fund manager in delivering this kind of asset allocation.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.